is real tension between truth and grace, and it is something that everybody who is serious about following Jesus can feel. And Jerry's going to be talking about that right now.
All right, good morning. Good to see all you guys here. It's two great concepts that we started talking about last week that you see all throughout the scriptures, and in particular in the New Testament. We started out last week about talking about the tension between these two concepts, grace and truth. The reason why we did that is because John, who came upon Jesus very early in the ministry of Jesus, he was there from the beginning. John, later in life, begins to write his memories of the life story of Jesus, and as he describes Jesus, and he could have used anything, as you can imagine, but he says that Jesus was full of grace and full of truth. And I close by saying that if you want to know what Jesus meant when he taught something, that what you needed to do was watch what he did. Watch what he did. And I said that's so important for us because as followers of Jesus, if we want people to take us seriously, we have got to, you know, when we talk about what we believe, we've got to make sure that our words line up with our actions. And at the end last week, the very last thing I said, when your words and your actions do not line up, that's hypocrisy. That's an accusation made towards people of faith. Maybe someone's accused you of that, or maybe you've heard someone say, well, all Christians are hypocrites, or everybody who goes to church is a hypocrite. When your words and actions do not line up, it's hypocrisy. When your words and actions do line up, that's called integrity. And that's something that we should all strive for. And that's why this issue of grace and truth is very important to us. And I said last week, and we kind of stopped in the middle of a longer message, but I said, what I want to do this week is we're going to go to some individual stories of how Jesus interacted with people during his lifetime and see how grace and truth played out into that. One that I think of just right off the top of my head was the story of the woman at the well. You remember they were Jesus and his guys. They were heading to a place, and the guys were hungry, and they said, we're going to go into town and get some food. So Jesus, as he's walking along the way, he comes to a well in the middle of the day where they would draw their water, and there was a woman there. Now, a couple things you need to know for context is that it was the women's job. Sorry, ladies. It was the women's job to gather the water for the family. They typically did it in the morning and they did it in the evening. They did it in the cooler part of the day before the sun got real hot and after the sun began to go down. And so they would gather water, and it was a social event, all of the ladies in the town. And remember, you're not talking about towns like we have, like Orlando or Miami, where there's millions of people. Most of the towns were not that crowded. There were several wells, obviously, where you could get money. But for some reason, this lady's coming in the middle of the day. No one else is with her. And so already we have kind of an interesting thing that happens here. But I want you to see where grace and truth in the life of Jesus comes in, just dealing with this person. So Jesus comes up and he asks her for a drink of water. Well, again, a couple things you need to know. Men typically did not talk to women. That's just the way the culture was. So Jesus broke out of that and he reached out to this woman, and she said, why are you asking me, a Samaritan woman, a woman from Samaria? Because Jesus obviously was a Jew, and there was a little bit of a racial friction that was there. And it's really kind of interesting because he says, well, if you knew who was talking to you, and we could get into this later. He says, if you knew who was talking to you, I could give you living water and you'd never thirst again. And you've all heard that part of the story. But there's another interesting part of the story, and because Jesus tells her this, and I think he had a smile on his face when he did. I kind of get the idea Jesus smiled a lot more than we do. And he knew where this was going. And so he smiled at her. He had kind of broke the ice just by actually speaking to her. And he said, you know, tell me about your husband. And she said, well, I don't have a husband. Okay. Now here's where truth came in. And I got this rock here to symbolize truth. Okay. Here's where truth's going to come in, because Jesus says, well, you're right. You've told me the truth. You've had five husbands, and the guy you're living with now, you're not even married to. Okay, that's called truth, by the way, in case some of you are wondering. That's some hard truth. Okay, and this was something that was true. And so you know, he reaches into this most painful part. I'm sure she wasn't proud of that. But he reaches into that and he speaks to her and he shows her grace. He shows her grace. He says, well, go and tell. And it's an amazing thing because this woman runs back to town. If you read the whole story in John, she runs back to town and tells people, you know, that this man spoke to me and that got their attention. And then they came out to hear Jesus. So you see grace and truth. I'm sorry, I meant to put a little grace card up here. So there we go. All right. So the rock is grace, or rock is truth, and we have grace. Then you come across, as Jesus is calling his disciples, he calls a guy by the name of Matthew, actually comes upon Matthew while he's at the place where he's his place of business. And before Jesus got there, you need to know this about Matthew, is that everybody already hated him. He wasn't the most famous guy in town. He was a tax gatherer. Rome was in charge. And the way that they would gather their taxes was they would hire a person from that area, from that geographical area, to be in charge of getting the taxes. So here is a Jew going to the other Jews saying, you need to pay Rome their taxes. And the way that the tax gatherers made their living was by adding on whatever they wanted to add to the Roman taxes. So, and everybody knew this was a corrupt system. And so Matthew would go to me if I was a Jew and say, well, your Roman taxes, you know, he'd figure they're $100 this year. You're going to pay $125. And I had to do it. He was hired by Rome. And so that was something you had to do. So Rome kind of looked down on these guys. They were just employees. But if you were a Jew, you really didn't like a fellow Jew making money off of you in the name of the people who had kind of come against you. So he was considered a traitor to his own people. It's interesting when you read in the scripture several times in the Gospels, it'll mention they were kind of like the tax gatherers are kind of like their own category of sinners, because over and over again in scripture in New Testament, they would talk about the people who went to hear Jesus, and then he'd say, and there were the sinners and there were the tax collectors. You know, it's like a whole nother level. I mean, these guys are bad, but if you think that's bad, at least you're not a tax collector. And so they had that going for him. But Jesus spots this guy. And he goes up to Matthew, and he knows what Matthew's reputation is. And remember, the guys Jesus has already called to follow him are all Jews. And so they're probably thinking, Jesus is going to really get this guy. All right? And he looks at Matthew and says, hey, Matthew, I want you to quit what you're doing and follow me. Quit what you're doing and follow me. And all these other guys didn't like it. And all of the Jews didn't like it. And they were afraid that if they had a tax gatherer in their group, that people would think that Jesus actually approved of tax gatherers and that they would be a part of that. And it was going to get a whole lot worse for these guys, because the first thing Jesus does is says, and by the way, I'm coming to your house to eat tonight. So call all your tax gatherer friends. And this is what we're going to do. So Jesus knows the truth of the guy and what he had done, and knew that it was a corrupt system, but instead he showed Matthew grace. He showed Matthew grace, and he said, I want you to follow me. I want you to follow me. And not only that, but I want to be a part of your life. I want to be a part of your life. Then you get to the end of the story of the life of Jesus, and you remember Jesus was crucified between two guys. We typically only talk about this around Easter time, but he's crucified between these two guys. The people who were crucified were typically the worst of the worst. You know, when it said they were thieves, and I think in the King James Version, it doesn't mean they, you know, broke into somebody's house and took something and that was it, or they shoplifted or something. These were like the worst of the worst. And they could not even trust these guys enough. Typically, you know, they would throw people in jail until they could pay back what they had taken or made them work or something like this. They couldn't even trust these guys that long. They said, these guys are worthy of being put to death. And you remember Jesus is going to be crucified between these two guys. And one of them spends his time that he has left mocking Jesus. You know, and if you're who you say you are, get us down with you and all this kind of thing. But there's another guy, and this guy's so cool. And here's the truth and grace. Listen, this guy simply says, hey, we're getting what we deserve. We're getting what we deserve. And there's a part of us that if it was just the grace side that Jesus, you know, we'd expect Jesus to say, oh, no. You don't deserve this. You have a good heart. You know, you're a good man. Don't be so hard on yourself. But he doesn't. He agrees with the guy. Yep, you deserve it. No argument here. But then the guy called on Jesus and said, today. He said, I believe you're the Son of God today. I want to be with you. I want to paraphrase here, but Jesus said, yeah, you're a sinner and you're deserving of this. But I want you to know today that when you breathe your last breath and when I breathe my last breath, that we're going to the same place. And Jesus told the man, today you will be with me in paradise. Today you'll be with me in paradise. And again, when you hear that story, there's a part of us, especially if you're like church world person, you know, that we're kind of like, wait a minute, time out, Jesus. Because it seemed like just a little while ago, a young rich guy came to you and said that he wanted to have eternal life. And what did he need to do to have eternal life? And you told him that in order to have eternal life, he needed to sell everything he had and he had to follow you the rest of his life. And then this guy on the cross with seconds left on the clock, you know, is going to get in. I mean, this sounds so confusing. I mean, you know, we have to give up everything to follow you, and yet this guy gets in at the last minute. I mean, he doesn't have to rededicate his life. He doesn't have to make an offering. He doesn't have to, you know, go to the synagogue or any of this. This just doesn't make sense. This is confusing. He has this last minute plea for mercy. And Jesus, you told him, today you'll be with me in paradise. Today, you, the worst of the worst, will be with me, the best of the best forever. Remember last week I told you there was a tension when grace and truth come in? There's a tension there. There's a part of us that says, wait a minute, why should this guy get in? And we had to do this, and he got to do this. And we begin to question the grace. I think probably the most famous story of all, and it finds its way into a story that John actually wrote about the life of Jesus. And most of you guys could get up here and teach this story for me, but I want to lead to a point today. And it's about a woman who was caught in the act of adultery. You remember the story? Woman who was caught in the act of adultery. And Jesus is teaching at the temple, and then there's a commotion, and these guys come, and they, you know the story, they throw this woman at the feet of Jesus and say, she was caught in the very act of adultery. And they reminded him of the Jewish law. Now, again, I can't speak for the rightness or wrongness of this, so I'm just stating facts. Jewish law said that anyone caught in the act of adultery was to be killed. Okay? And the way that they were killed was you would pick up stones, and you would kind of get in a circle, and you would stone the person. And it's just exactly what you thought. You would throw stones until that person died. All right? And that was what the Jewish law said at the time. That's something they could have done. The judges, the legal system could have just done this and said, that's what we do when this happens. That's the way we've done it for hundreds of years. And so she's caught in the act of adultery. Jesus, you're Jewish. She's Jewish. You know what the rules are. The law says she has to be put to death by stoning. And what Jesus could have said was, well, according to the Roman law, though, which, remember, they were under, you can't put her to death. So leave her alone. He could have said that, but that's not what he did. It's not what he did. He said this. He said, okay, I'll play your game. We'll play by the law of Moses. Let's stone her. But here's how we're going to do it. He said, I want you to start with the person who doesn't have any sin in their life. And the person who has never committed adultery in your heart. The person who has never lusted after another man or a woman. You get to be first. All right? So whether it was an older person or a younger person in the crowd, typically it was the men who were allowed to do this, who were, you know, in charge of stoning the people. And you know, he said, you know, you guys line up, and whichever one of you has the least sin in your life, you get to throw the first stone, and then the next guy, and then the next, another. We're going to do this. We're going to do it right, is what he said. Okay? I mean, you know, the person who thinks, oh, I would never do anything like that. You start. And here's how John records the story, and we'll put it up on the screen. It says, and when the accusers heard this, they slipped away one by one, beginning with the oldest. That's an interesting line, beginning with the oldest. Why do you think that was? I'm 68 years old. I've probably sinned a whole lot more than a 34-year-old person has. I've had 34 years of evil thoughts. I've had 34 more years of, you know, here's what I would do. And here's what this person deserves. So it's like the oldest to the youngest. And then I love this part, until only Jesus was left. Now, again, if you're this woman and only Jesus is there and he hasn't said anything yet, you're still in fear. He's a Jewish man. By law and tradition and custom, he has a right to stone you. And by the way, who had no sin in their life? Jesus. I mean, honestly, to the Jew, I mean, this sounds awful to us, but to the Jews, Jesus could have said, okay, I guess I'll have to do it. And he could have done this, and he would have been within all of the legal rights. Okay? And that's what we call truth. And that's what we call truth. Then Jesus stood up again and said to the woman, where are your accusers? Where's all the guys? Didn't even one of them condemn you? And she said, no, sir. Then Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life of sin. And so where there was truth, grace enters the picture. Here's what you deserve. Here's what you deserve. But here is what I'm going to give you. All right? All of a sudden, the law of Moses, when Jesus speaks, all of a sudden this law of Moses, this law of retribution, of paying people back for their sins, begins to break down. And everyone goes away. And I've always said, if I could picture this scene, and if I was a director of a movie doing this, and you know, you'd see the dust and the crowds and all of this kind of thing, and everybody'd have the stones in their hands, and I've always said the only sound you heard for a while was the sound of those rocks hitting the ground as they let them go and walked away. You know, but they all go away. Jesus made everybody uncomfortable. And he looks at the woman and he says, I'm not going to condemn you, but go and leave your life of sin. So you have to ask yourself, which is it? Here's that tension again. I don't condemn you, which is grace, or you're a sinner, stop doing it. That's the truth. Okay? You're a sinner, stop doing it. So I wrote in my notes, which is it? I do not condemn you, or you're a sinner? And I wrote, and the answer is yes. The answer is both. There's this weird tension, okay, when it comes to the love of Jesus. I don't condemn you, now go and live your life of sin. You know, but did you have to bring up the sin part? Well, yeah, because that was the truth. That's something that was true. Well, then how can you say she's not condemned? Because that's grace. That's grace. And the only one who could say you're not condemned is the one who had no sin in their life, and that was Jesus. And we could go on and on, and I could pull story after story after story. And I would just encourage you, in the weeks and months ahead, as you read your Bible, I always encourage you to read through the Gospels, in particular the book of John. Look, every time Jesus entered into a personal dynamic with someone, there's always going to be truth and there's always going to be grace. It's always going to be there because Jesus was full of grace and truth. John said it just kind of overflowed out of him. It's what you would see if you saw Jesus. And again, as a church, we so try to get this right. And it's not always easy because we're not Jesus, you know? And sometimes we say, well, they really need to hear the truth, and we forget about grace. And sometimes we're kind of like, oh, you know, they've had it rough, and it's just all grace, but then we don't show truth. And so as a church, we try to get this right, and we don't always get it right. And since we're dealing with people and with each other, we always find ourselves in these difficult situations. And we say something like, God, we're just not going to be just the truth church. And that would be so easy, all right? If you're like me, I was brought up in a truth church. And I learned how to do it. I'm good at it. And because I'm a talker, I can just make you feel bad every week if that's what we were, all right? I mean, I can get the Bible out, and I could find three or four verses, and I could just beat you over the head with it. And some of you would take it because you'd say, well, he knows the Greek, and he knows the Hebrew, and so he must know more than I. And after all, Jerry said so, you know, and I could do that. And here's what I said at the beginning. I get the truth part when it's for someone else. But when it's about me, I want the grace part. I want the grace part, okay? So let me kind of tie this together today. It's been a little messy, so let me kind of tie this together. I said at the beginning, if you want to know what Jesus meant when he said something, watch what he did. So if you want to know what Jesus meant when he said love one another, we need to watch how Jesus loved. Watch how Jesus loved. Do you know how Jesus loved? Have you picked it up yet from any of this? When there was sin, he called it sin. Go and sin no more. What you're doing is wrong. The woman at the well, No way, ma'am, you should have had five husbands and then this one you're living. No way that should have happened. The thief on the cross, yeah, you deserve what you're getting, but I'm going to offer you this. I mean, we see this over and over again. He calls sin, sin, but then he pays for it. He pays that Jewish law of retribution that someone has to pay for sin. Someone has to pay. He says, I'll be the one that does it. And he declares to everyone, I don't condemn you. Now that I have called sin, sin, and now that I have paid for it and said that I don't condemn you because I've done that, now I want all of you to leave your life of sin. And if you do not leave your life of sin, I'm going to keep loving you anyway. And if you cannot leave your life of sin, I'm going to keep loving you anyway. And if the shrapnel of your own sin has left you to the place where you're not even sure you will ever be able to walk away from the complexity of your sin, I'm still going to love you anyway. And if someone has sinned against you and it has sent you into a spiral of self-destructive behavior that you're not sure you'll ever recover from, Jesus says, I will still love you. Grace is always going to be there. The truth is always going to be there. And Jesus would look at those people today, and he would look at me today, and he would look each of you in the eye, and you that are watching today, and he would say, the truth is, you are a sinner. You are a sinner. But the grace is, I don't condemn you. And no one will ever love you more than I will. And there's a tension there. There's a tension there. It's not in my notes, so you guys in the back just kind of hang loose for a second. But I was thinking of that today, and just as I read that tension, I thought about when I was growing up. And I grew up in a good church and good people, but I told you, we were about 80% truth and about 20% grace. And just about every Sunday, I felt like I was like the worst person in the world when I came to church. Because about halfway through the sermon, it would be like, I would just be under such conviction. And I went to kind of church growing up where at the end they would get up again and they would sing, you know, like 900 verses of the same song over and over again. And you'd come forward and you'd pray. And it's like every week I felt like, I don't even know if I'm saved because I sinned this week, you know. And till later I learned that that was self-condemnation, that condemnation didn't come from my Savior. Okay, that his grace covered my sin, but there was always that tension, you know, and it took me to later in life, and that's why I teach the way I do, because I don't want you guys to have to go through that, just the constant, you know, being torn up inside. There's a tension, and there's a tension, though, that, by the way, if we ever just try to resolve it, we'll lose something very important. So you know why here at Atlantic Coast we can't let go of the truth? The reason that we have to keep saying what is true and this, it's because we believe that sin has a consequence. Somebody said it this way, sin has a gotcha. Okay? Sin has a gotcha. And God doesn't want you to be hurt with sin. But there's always a consequence with sin. So when we see someone making a choice, we not only see the choice, we see the consequence that's attached. And while we may say, you shouldn't do that, and they go, that's not very kind, you know, we ought to have freedom to make, yeah, but the kind thing is to warn about the consequence. And so we can't ever let go of the truth here. We can't ever come to a place where we say, hey, do what you want, God loves everybody, and, you know, we'll figure it out later. No, it's our job as a church to say, this is what's right, not only from up here, but as we interact with one another, as friends, we watch each other, we're accountable to one another. There's always a consequence. There's always a hurt. There's always a regret. There's always a sorrow with every sin. And that's the truth. And the thing is, every one of you here today and every one of you watching know that's true. There's always a regret, a sorrow, a hurt. So constantly God says, here's what is true. And here's what is true. Here's how you should treat people. Here's what you should do with your morality. Here's how you have to be honest. Here's why you can't cheat. Here's why you can't steal. Here's why you need to confess. Here's why you need to be accountable, because sin has a gotcha. Sin has a consequence. And that's why we can never let go of the law. And the reason why we here at Atlantic Coast can never let go of grace is because sin already has us. We've felt the consequence and the regret and the sorrow. And grace is our only way back. Grace is the only way home. Grace is the only way that you and I will ever know that we've connected or reconnected with our Heavenly Father. So every one of us needs to hear the truth constantly. And every one of us needs grace constantly. There's only one place I know of where you hear both. Where you hear both. Where we're trying to be full of grace and truth. So listen to me. I want to talk to Atlantic Coast for just a couple minutes here. If Jesus was the embodiment of grace and truth, if he was full of grace and truth, and if we as the church are his body, and if Jesus was the embodiment of grace and truth, and we're his body, we're his hands, we're his feet, we are the best expression of Jesus that anyone will ever know. And if we believe that, then we're going to have to be comfortable with the messiness. And we're going to have to be comfortable with the unfairness. And we're going to have to be comfortable with the inconsistency. And all of the stuff that goes along with managing and hanging on to the tension of grace and truth. And after almost 32 years of doing this here at this church, and a bunch of years of us trying to get this right, and a bunch of conversations with people who have been here, and they got their feelings hurt, or they got offended over the truth, and I watched them, and over the years, they begin to get re-involved, and they begin to recycle back. Here's what I'm convinced of. Our church will be at its best when we embrace both grace and truth and never let go of either one. Never let go of either one. And it's going to be uncomfortable sometimes when we have to tell the truth to someone. It's just messy. But if we're going to be like Christ, we're not only going to tell them the truth, but we're going to show them what grace looks like. We're going to show them what grace looks like. If you want to know what Jesus meant when he said love one another, there it is. It's messy. It's messy. It can be difficult. And sometimes we don't know what to do with the tension and we feel it and it's heavy, but we cannot let go of either one because there was a time in each of our lives and there will be a time in each of our lives in the future when we will desperately, individually need a massive dose of truth and along with it a massive dose of grace. And the church as the body of Christ is to be the dispenser of both. So let's be a church that's all about the grace of God. Let's be a church that's all about the truth of God. And let's continue to pray that God will allow us to somehow manage that tension that we feel. So that people from every walk of life, of every, you know, decision they've made, lifestyle, choice, race, you know, sex, whatever, any of these things that are going on. So that people from every walk of life will know that there is a God who has said, yes, you've sinned, but I've paid for it on the cross. Because of that, you're not condemned. I love you, so follow me. And that's the message of the church. And you know what? There's going to be a whole lot of people that'll never pick up the Bible and read that on a page. They'll never read and know about the stories that I just told you. So my challenge is maybe they'll see it in you and me. Maybe they'll see truth and grace in you and me. And maybe they'll find their way to a place like this church where they can be part of a body, where they can hear the truth, and where they will experience grace in such an amazing way that it will change their life forever. Let's be that kind of church. Let's be that for people. Messy, confusing, and yeah, we get it, you know, but that's what it is. That's the tension. And Jesus was full of grace and truth. Let's be that for people. Let's pray. Father, we thank you again for the opportunity to be here today, for the chance to sing together and to sing those words and to read those words and have them touch our heart and speak to our heart even before I get up here and even before we open the Word of God. So God, we're thankful for music and the opportunity to sing and be a part of it. God, we're thankful for a Bible that you've given us that tells the story of an eyewitness to the life of Jesus. So we don't have to wonder if this happened. I mean, it's here. It's documented. It's reliable. And we see how Jesus did, and then he tells us to follow him. In other words, we ought to react to people in those situations in the same way that he did. And it's not easy for us because most times we're not full of grace and we're not full of truth. We kind of struggle. But you've challenged us today and last week that because Jesus was full of grace and truth, that we who are his followers should strive to be full of grace and truth. God, help me as a pastor to lead a church that's full of grace and truth. And may good rumors begin to start about this church around this town. That if you want to hear the truth, even if it's hard, that's where you go. But if you want to find a bunch of people that'll just show you some grace, that's where you need to go. Father, we're thankful for the example of our Savior. We're thankful all that he did for us on the cross. We're thankful that he rose again. and that he's promised us an eternal home in heaven with you one day. We're thankful for that. We pray this in his name. Everyone said, amen. Amen.
Come here.